Right. Shaun Moss is an applicant. He's a computer scientist. He's a writer, as well as the secretary of the Mars Society Australia. Good afternoon, Shaun.
Good day, Brendan. How are you?
I'm well, thanks. Look, this is an extraordinary step. I know that you've got an interest in Mars, and we'll talk about that in a moment. But are you sure about this? You sure you want to go to Mars and take a one-way trip there?
Yes, I'm quite sure. I've always planned to go to Mars. It's a lifelong passion for me. So when the opportunity came up, I knew I was going to apply.
Okay. Let's talk about the passion. What is it about Mars that makes you love it so much?
It may be a little bit hard to define. I've always had an interest in planets. Probably about 1999, I had a bit of an epiphany reading Red Mars by Kim Stanley Robinson. I realised that within my lifetime, humans were going to settle another planet. And I thought, that's got to be the biggest thing that's happening in my life, and I want to be part of that. So since then, I've dedicated myself to working on ideas for human settlement of Mars.
Okay. What sort of ideas have you been working on?
I'm just about to present human to Mars mission architecture that I've been working on. So ideas for a low cost mission to send 6 people to Mars. And I'm presenting that at the Australian Space Science Conference in a couple of weeks. Other than that, I guess I've mainly been working on writing. I've been working on in-situ resource utilisation concepts, or ways to survive, be self-sufficient on the Martian surface.
Because that would be very hard, like wouldn't
that. Yeah, that's right. The main appeal of Mars, there are a number of reasons. Mars is the planet most like Earth. But one of the main appeals that the Mars has over, say, the Moon, is that we can live there. It has all of the ingredients necessary for life. It has water, it has carbon, nitrogen, all the metals, anything that we need. So it's just a matter of having the technology to access those materials, and we can build a civilization there.
I thought the water on Mars question was not resolved yet.
Yes, it is.
It is? Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
How do you
it's
get
been
the water?
Resolved over the... most of it is, well, it's all frozen. There has been some evidence of liquid water on the surface, but it's pretty much all frozen in the crust, in the permafrost. So you have to melt it. And probably the best way to do that is using microwaves.
Mm-hmm. So you'd generate electricity in a solar fashion, beam that at the ice, drink it.
Yeah, effectively, yeah, in a nutshell.
Okay. Now, back to the Mars One Foundation. How confident are you that they can do what they're saying they can do in pretty much the time frame and in the order they've got to send some automated expeditions up there to set things up before you as humans would even arrive? Is that plausible?
It's plausible, but you know, the jury's still out. The timeline that they've set themselves is fairly aggressive. If you think the Apollo program, you know, was achieved in less than 10 years on a massive national budget. They're trying to do something that NASA believes can't be done. You know, so they've got to raise $6 billion. They've got to develop a number of new technology items. It's a formidable challenge. I think that they will achieve it if they're persistent, maybe not on the timeline that they've set. But, you know, if they believe in it, they're certainly gathering momentum. They've got the whole world engaged with the idea, so... yeah, it is plausible.
Well, $6 million, that's a fair bit. Billion.
Yeah, billion, yeah, that's right. Well, they're basing it, the main comparison that they draw is with the Olympics. The Olympics generates about $4 billion in ad revenue. So they're saying, well, $6 billion for humans to Mars should be achievable because it's a much, much bigger media event. So it's all based around the fact that this is going to be a global media event and it's going to have the attention of the world and they're going to sell ads.
So if you
work for Google...
So if you were to go, you'd have a sponsored space suit probably covered in stickers.
It's a scary thought, but it may be the case.
I got a question for you. I'm wondering if you think that the timeline's quite aggressive and may not come off, you're putting your life in the hands of these guys. Is that a good move? Do you feel safe?
I've thought about this. It is a risk. I would want to be very engaged with all of their engineering, all of their plans, rather than just say, yep, whatever you say, I'll just jump in a rocket and go. I'm quite interested in how they're going to make enough food, how the habitats are going to be structured, how they're going to get all the materials there. There's a lot of question marks, and they haven't provided a lot of these engineering details. They've provided mostly artwork and concepts, but, you know, it's not quite enough information has been provided yet to feel really safe about it. Mm. So, yeah, I'd want to be finding out a hell of a lot more.
Mm. And I'm wondering also, once you got there, presumably it's one way, because while we can mount a rocket from here, it'd be very hard to mount a rocket from there to come back. So if it's a one-way trip indeed, aren't you going to miss things? Wouldn't you miss the feeling of the surf? And I don't know.
Yes, yeah, definitely. And it's a big consideration. You know, I'd miss nature. I'd miss just being in a busy city street and you know, just those moments of life. I love to travel and see the world, and those kind of things would be hard to miss. But I've got those memories, and being part of such a grand adventure would certainly go a long way to making up for that. And being able to go outside the hab and walk around on a virtually empty planet, and knowing that you're at the forefront of human exploration, it's pretty massive.
Mm. I'm sure you're familiar with some of the more nightmarish scenarios that we've seen in science fiction films. People stranded on various planets, everything going wrong, someone contracts a horrible disease, alien incursions. Did you lie awake at night thinking about what that might look like?
No, not really. I don't think anything like that is realistic. The dangers are far less spectacular. It's things like just having enough resources to keep everyone alive, and psychological factors, of course. Everyone's going to be cooped up together. It's going to be really important that everyone gets on, and I think that they will, because just we already have online communities built up around this mission, and you know, everyone's become friends through this shared interest. So.
Mm.
It bodes well, I think.
I guess hard drives have got so small and cheap these days, you can almost take, you know, any of your photos and movies that you would care to watch for the rest of your life.
Look, think of how far the internet has advanced in the past 20 years. How much more advanced is it going to be in 10 more? We're only going to be 20 minutes away in terms of network lag. So, I mean, we're going to have Facebook. We're going to have access to the cloud. We're going to have access to music and movies and whatever we want. So it's not like we're going to be cut off from the rest of humanity.
Yeah.
We'll still be able to chat with our friends and, you know, if not real-time chat, at least send emails. So.
Yeah, I can imagine all your Facebook party invitations. You'll be like, nah, can't make it.
Sorry, on Mars.
Still. All right. Well, it's not till 2023 at the earliest, so we may get a chance to talk with you again and see how preparations are going, if you're one of the supposedly lucky ones that gets into that first expedition.
That would be great.
All right. Hey, thanks so much for the chat today, Shaun.
Thanks, Brent. Very grateful. Thank you.
Cheerio. See you, mate. That's Shaun Moss. And look, if things go as he would hope they do, he could be heading to Mars.